始めましょう。
はい、Good evening. Last class, we started functions. I gave the definition of a function last class. I told you, consider two sets, A and B. A is one set, B is another set. Define a mapping from A to B. Define a mapping from A to B. In such a way, f is a function from A to B. F is a function from A to B. F is a function from A to B. Consider two sets A and B. We are defining a mapping correspondence from A to B in such a way, for every element in A, there exists a unique image in B. For every element in A, there exists a unique image in B. Then that correspondence is called a function. That correspondence is called function. I gave an example last class. Consider set of all students in a class. Consider set of all students in a class. Consider set of all ages, completed ages 1 to 100. Roll number 1, roll number 2, roll number 3, roll number 40. Like there are 40 students in a class. We are having a correspondence in such a way for one student. The image is the completed age. Completed age can be 18 or 19 or 20, like that. Two students can have same age, but one student cannot have two ages. Two students can have same age, but one student cannot have two ages. That is, for every element here, one student cannot say, I don't have age. If that is the case, that type of correspondence is called a function. Here, f is a function from A to B. A is a set of all students, B is a set of all ages. For every student, for a student X, the image is Y. The corresponding image is Y. Y is nothing but X completed age. So for roll number 10, age is 18. Roll number 20, age is 18. Roll number 7, age is 19. Roll number 25, age is 21, and so on. So for every student, so we cannot leave any student. All the students will be having a completed age. So therefore, for every element in A, we have a unique image in B. That correspondence is called a function. Okay. So having seen function, we are seeing different types of functions. We are taking one simple function. I am taking a function from z to z such that x goes to 2x. X goes to 2x. That is, for every element in z, the image is 2 times that element. For example, image of 4 is 8. Image of 0 is 0. Image of 12 is 24. For every element, we have a corresponding image here. There is nothing but 2 times that element. So therefore, automatically, we can simply conclude this is a function. So f from z to z is a function. We are discussing about varieties of functions one by one. I can give a lot of examples of functions, but let us take varieties of functions. One example, because already you have seen this. 10th standard. Suppose I am taking one simple function, that is to understand, I am giving a simple example. A, B. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Here, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1 goes to 2, 2 goes to 3, 3 goes to 4, 4 goes to 5, 5 goes to 6. All the elements in A has got images. At the same time, there is a one-to-one correspondence. If these two elements are different, their images are also different. these two elements are different, their images are different. So therefore this function is one to one function, because if x1 is not equal to x2, if x1 is not equal to x2, then automatically image f of x1 is also not equal to f of x2. So different elements are having different images. We call that function as one to one function. And before that, here we can call domain and codomain. This is our domain. This is our codomain. This is our domain. And the range 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. These elements are related to 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we can simply come to a conclusion. The range is nothing but 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on. Now let us not worry about that. Let us come to this. Okay. First of all, let us take an odd function. A mapping f from x to y is called an odd function if f of minus x is equal to minus f of x. So we are defining a function. Once a function is defined, we call this function as odd function if f of minus x is equal to minus f of x. This function, a function satisfying this condition, is called odd function. The example of this function is nothing but sin x is an odd function. Sin x is an odd function because f of minus x is nothing but sin of minus x is nothing but minus sin x. Similarly, sin x, tan x, x cube, x power 5, etc. are all examples of odd functions. So odd function is one in which f of minus x is equal to minus f of x. Even function. A mapping f from x to y is said to be even if f of minus x is equal to f of x itself. Example of even function. F of minus x is equal to f of x. This is a criteria for saying it's an even function. Example is fx is equal to cos x. Because f of minus x is equal to cos of minus x, which is nothing but cos x itself. Therefore, example of even functions are cos x, x square, x power 4, x power 6, etc. are all even functions. So we have defined an odd function. We have defined an even function. Now let us take another function. Greatest integer function. It's a very, very important function. This will be used for all computer examination. We can spend some few seconds regarding this function. Okay. F of x is equal to x within this bracket. This is called the greatest integer function. This function is called greatest integer function. That means this is called the greatest integer function of x. Notation, we call it this. Greatest integer function of 4.1 is 4. The greatest integer function of 4.9 is also 4. The greatest integer function of 4.99 is also 4. Whereas the greatest integer function of minus 5.1 is nothing but minus 6. The greatest integer function of minus 5.11 is also minus 6. Why? Why it is so? What is the definition? What is the criteria to define greatest integer function? Okay. Now, so greatest integer function of 4.1 is 4. We are getting only the integral part. 4.9, we are writing only the integral part. 4.99, we are writing only the integral part. Here, we are not writing integral part. Minus 5.1, we are writing minus 6, and so on. Why is it so? The reason being, for example, you write all integers, you mark all integers on the real axis. You mark all integers on the real axis. 4.1 is here. To find greatest integer function of 4.1, you take all integers less than 4.1. 4, 3, 2, 1, 0, minus 1. You take all integers less than 4.1. Among these integers, the greatest is the greatest integer function. Greatest is 4. That is the greatest integer function of 4.1. So, for 4.1, the greatest integer function of 4.1 is, among all integers less than 4.1, the greatest is 4. Therefore, that is the greatest integer function of 4.1. Whereas, you write 0, minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4, minus 5, minus 6, minus 7. Minus 4.1 it is here. Minus 4.1 is here. Below minus 4.1 you group all integers minus 5, minus 6, minus 7, minus 8, minus 9, minus 10, etc. Among that, greatest is minus 5. Therefore, the greatest integer function of minus 4.1, we write like this. This is nothing but dot. The greatest integer function of minus 4.1 is nothing but minus 5. Because less than minus 4.1, minus 5, minus 6, minus 7 are all the integers. Among that, the greatest is this one. This is one definition. Another definition is, to find the greatest integer function of x, you write x as x plus gamma, where gamma lies between 0 and 1. You write x as x plus gamma, where gamma lies between 0 and 1. Then, the greatest integer function of x is nothing but capital X. This capital X is nothing but the integral part. And gamma is the decimal part, strictly positive, lying between 0 and 1. Now, the greatest integer function of, you apply this definition, x is equal to x plus gamma, where gamma lying between 0 and 1. You write only the integral part, that's the answer. Over. Now, you write 4.1. When x is 4.1, this is the greatest integer function of x, is greatest integer function of 4.1 is written as 4 plus 0.1. This 0.1 lies between 0 and 1, though integral part is 4. So 4 is the answer. 4 is the greatest integer function of 4.1. Similarly, for x is equal to minus 5.1, you write a minus 5.1 as minus 5 minus 0.1. Minus 5 minus 0.1. Now you write minus 5 as minus 6 plus 1. Minus 5 is minus 6. 1 minus 0.1 is nothing but 0.9. So this decimal part is less than 1. It's lying between 0 and 1. Therefore, the greatest integer function is nothing but minus 6. Therefore, the greatest integer function of minus 5.1 is nothing but minus 6. By this definition, because we are writing this as x plus gamma, when gamma is in between 0 and 1, greater than 0 and less than 1, the decimal, then this is the greatest integer function of minus 5.1. Okay, this greatest integer function can be traced. So, I will draw this curve. Y is equal to f of x, which is nothing but the greatest integer function of x. For 0, it is 0. For 0.1, it is 0. For 0.99, it is 0. So for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, etc. 0 to 1, it is 0. For 1, we get 1. 1 to 1.99, we can write like this. We can draw the curve. From 2 to 2, when x is equal to 2, it is 2. 2.1, it is 2. So we get like this. So we are getting a staircase function. It is like a staircase, we can climb up. So this is the greatest integer function, tracing of greatest integer function. It is a discontinuous function, obviously, because at x is equal to 1, we are having a discontinuity here. At x is equal to 1, we take our hand to draw this point. For x is equal to 2, it is discontinuous. For x is equal to 3, it is discontinuous. At all integral points, it is discontinuous. At all integral points, it is discontinuous. So, therefore, we simply come to a conclusion. The greatest integer function is a discontinuous function. This is the tracing of greatest integer function. Okay. So, greatest integer function of 3.9 is 3, minus 4.1 is minus 5, minus 1. Let us take an identity function. A function f from x to a set y is called identity function if f of xi is equal to xi itself. That is, f of x is equal to x itself for all x belonging to the given set x. So, f of x is equal to x, we call that function as identity function. So, how do you take identity function? The identity function is taken like this. 1, 2, 3, 4. Image of 1 is 1, image of 2 is 2, image of 3 is 3, image of 4 is 4. So this is called the identity function. We call this function as identity function. Image of every element is that element itself. That element itself. Okay. 1-to-1 function, we have seen for x1 not equal to x2, f of x1 is not equal to f of x2. We have seen the definition of 1-to-1 function. We have seen examples also. A is a function, B is a function. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1 goes to 1, 2 goes to 2, 3 goes to 3, 4 goes to 4. Here, automatically it is 1 to 1. It is also called onto function because 1, 2, 3, 4, no element is left out here. If you have one element extra, which is not onto, if you don't have that element, you don't have that element here. No element is left out without a pre-image. So therefore, automatically, this is an onto function. This is nothing but onto function. Whereas, if you have like this, 1, 2, 3, 1, 7, 1 goes to 1, 2 goes to 7, 3 goes to 7. And we are having some element extra here, which is not having a pre-image, This is called into function. If you are able to find one element in this set, which is not having pre-image, we call that function as the into function. Here, no element is there without pre-image, so therefore this is called the onto function. This is 1-to-1 onto, this is not 1-to-1 onto, this is into function. This comes under many one function. Okay. Many one function, two or more elements will be mapped onto the same element. It's a function, at the same time two or more elements will be mapped onto the same function. We call that as if x1 is not equal to x2, but f of x1 is equal to f of x. F of x1 is y1, f of x2 is also y1. So, if x1 is not equal to x2, f of x1 is equal to f of x2, we call that function as mini one function. So, this is a mini one function, it is picturized here. Okay. Onto function, onto function, 1-to-1 onto, 1-to-1 into, all these things you can easily understand because it's a good portion. It's a automatically into function because we are having one element which is not having pre-image, it's an into function. Inverse function. Now, we will define inverse function. The function is in such a way, is x goes to x plus 1, x goes to f of, that is, f of x is equal to x plus 1, f of x is equal to x plus 1, or in other words, y is equal to x plus 1, in this case, it's a function. This function is 1-to-1 and onto. And four elements are different, four images are different. So here y is equal to x plus 1. We can take inverse function like this. So this is from a to b. We can define the function from b to a. 2 goes to 1, 3 goes to 2, 4 goes to 3 and 5 goes to 4. 5 goes to 4. This is inverse function. This is called the inverse function. So 1 goes to 2, inverse function 2 goes to 1. Here 3 goes to 1, 3 goes to 2, 4 goes to 3, 5 goes to 4. X goes to y minus 1. You can ask one question. Here, f inverse x is nothing but x minus 1. When f of x is x plus 1, f inverse x is x minus 1. Or in the place of y minus 1, your y minus 1 replace y by x, you get the inverse function. So therefore, a function is, an inverse function exists only when the given function is 1 to 1 and odd 2. Only when the function is 1 to 1 odd 2, it is possible for us to find the inverse function. Otherwise, it is not. So therefore, this function is 1 to 1 and therefore, automatically 1 on 2. Therefore, automatically f inverse exists, that is also 1 to 1 on 2. Therefore, the inverse exists only when the function is 1 to 1 on 2. Okay. Inverse function. Hence, we come to a conclusion, f inverse exists only when f is 1 to 1 and on 2, not otherwise. Okay, composite function. F is a function from x to y, g is a function from y to z. Then the function fi from x to z is called a composite function. Is called a composite function. Now our example. We are having three sets. A, B, C. We are defining a function from A to B. We are defining a function from B to C. Then automatically we are defining a function from A to C, we call that as H. H is nothing but FOG or GOF, we can say. GOF. This is called a composite function. This is called a composite function. First, you find the image under F, then get the image under G. You get automatically image of H under from A to C. For example, image of F under that is under this function 1 goes to 2, under this function 2 goes to 3. Therefore, automatically H of 1 is nothing but 3. H of 1 is nothing but 3. Like that, for every element here, we can define the image here in C, and that function is called composite function. That function is called composite function. Okay. Now, let us not discuss these things, because we are discussing these things later on. We will discuss all these things later on. Now, let us take directly limit of a function. Let's take a limit of a function. Now, before finding limit, I will give some introduction about limit. Suppose you want to go to Bangalore. You want to go to Bangalore from Pondicherry. You go to a bus stand, enquire, and the bus wala says, if you catch the bus at 10 o'clock in the evening, next day morning, 6 a.m., it will reach. Next day morning, 6 a.m., it will reach Bangalore. You get a ticket, sitting in the bus. At 10 o'clock, you are sitting in the bus. 10, 11, 12, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, that is 1, 2, 3, 4. So like that, at 5 o'clock, we are nearing Bangalore. 5 a.m. we are nearing Bangalore. 5:30 will be very near to Bangalore. At 6 exactly, the bus reaches Bangalore. That means this concept is written as, as the time approaches 6 a.m., the bus approaches Bangalore. Bus approaches Bangalore. That is, this is a limit concept. You are getting into the bus. As the time approaches 6 a.m., automatically the bus approaches Bangalore. So we are writing this in the form of a limit like this. I'll give another example. You consider a function y is equal to 1 by x. A simple function we are taking. When x is equal to 10, automatically y is equal to 1 by 10, that is 0.1.
when x is equal to 100, y is equal to 1 by 100, that is equal to 0.01. When x is equal to 1000, y is equal to 1 by 1000, that is equal to 0.001, and so on. When x is equal to 10,000, y is equal to 1 by 10,000, that is 0.0001.
So from this table, we infer that as x increases, 10, 100, 1000, 10,000, and so on, as x increases, the value of y decreases. The value of y decreases. 0.1, 0.01, 0.001, 0.0001. It goes on decreasing. That means, as x approaches a big number, 1 by x approaches a small number. We write this concept in the form of a limit like this. As x tends to infinity, that means x becomes larger and larger, 1 by x becomes smaller and smaller, it becomes ultimately 0. It approaches 0. That is, as x approaches a big number, x 10, 100, 1000, 10,000, 1 lakh, 1 Google, like that, 1 by x approaches a small number, that is 0.1, 0.01, 0.001, 0.001. Ultimately, at one stage you get 0.00, many knots, that means it's nearly equal to 0. So we are writing this in the form of a limit like this in mathematics. So a limit extends to infinity of 1 by x is equal to 0. This is limit concept. Now, in general, if some function is there, f of x is a function, limit extends to a of f of x is simply f of a. That means what? As x approaches a, f of x approaches f of a. For example, if you take a function y is equal to x squared, when x is 1, y is 1, x is 2, y is 4, x is 3, y is 9, x is 4, y is 16, as x becomes 5, well, y becomes 25, that is y squared, that's 25. X tends to a of f of x is equal to f of a. So to find the limit of a function of x tends to a, you replace x by a, f of a, you get the value of the limit. Always it is not so. Because if you take this, limit extends to 1 of x square minus 1 by x minus 1. If you apply limit to the numerator, we get 0, 1 minus 1, 0. Denominator, we get 0 by 0. 0 by 0 is called, the 0 by 0 is called indeterminate form. Indeterminate form. Which means, we all know, 0 into 1 is 0, we'll take like this. 0 into 1 is 0, therefore 0 by 0, we say it is 1. 0 into 2 is 0, therefore 0 by 0 is 2. 0 into 3 is 0, therefore 0 by 0 is 3. You can say which is correct, which is wrong. We come to a conclusion, all are correct, all are wrong. Ambiguity. Therefore, that form is called, the 0 by 0 form is called the indeterminate form. That 0 by 0 form, we cannot determine it is 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 or whatever it may be. We cannot determine. That's why this particular form is called indeterminate form. Now, whenever you have an indeterminate form, I gave that in that example, limit extends to 1 of x square minus 1 by x minus 1. This gives 0 by 0 form. This 0 by 0 form indicates, there is some factor to be cancelled out. After cancelling that factor, if you apply limit, we get the required limit as 2. The required limit is 2 and not 0 by 0. Why so? That factor has to be cancelled out. After cancelling that common factor, we get the required limit. Therefore,
this 0 by 0 indeterminate form implies some factor has to be cancelled out in this quotient function.
So that is mentioned here, and the limit is ultimately 2. So let us see all these things. Let us see all these things one by one. Now see, we are having a polynomial function in the numerator, a polynomial function in the denominator. As x tends to 0, we are concerned with the values of x near 0, but not with the value 0 itself. As x approaches 0, 0.1, 0.01, 0.001, so we can easily feel that, ax plus bx square etc., ax, capital Ax, capital Bx square etc., x is taken out, we are cancelling x, you get a plus bx plus cx square etc., here a plus bx and so on. Now apply the limit. After cancelling that common factor, I told you whenever you get 0 by 0 form, one factor has to be cancelled out, and after cancelling the common factor, we get a by a. So this is the limit, provided a is not equal to 0, capital A is not equal to 0. If each a and a is 0, then the limit is not equal to a by a. So if a is 0, a capital A is also 0, then limit is not equal to a by a. So therefore, if the a is not equal to 0, a capital A is not equal to 0, automatically limit is a by capital A. Suppose if a is 0, capital A not equal to 0, the limit is 0 by a, that is 0, the value of the limit is 0. If a is not equal to 0, that a is not equal to 0, capital A is equal to 0, a by 0 is infinity, that means the expression tends to infinity. We say the expression tends to infinity. So it's a very good example to find the limit, to find the limit of this function ax plus bx square etc. We are discussing under various cases, when a and capital A are both 0, capital A and small a both not equal to 0, small a is 0, capital A is not equal to 0, small a not equal to 0, capital A is equal to 0. In all the cases, we are getting the limit like this. Okay, so that is discussed here in this example. Okay, limit extends to 0. 0, 0, 0, 0, 2 by 6, 1 by 8. Here, we don't have, you need not hesitate, automatically you apply limit. f of a you find here, f of a by phi of a. Extends to 0, 0, 0, 2 by 2 here, 0, 0, 6 here, 1 by 3. Limit y tends to infinity of 3 plus 2y plus y square here, it is not y square, it is y square, phi minus y square. So, when y tends to infinity, what do you say? You convert in terms of x by giving substitution y is equal to 1 by x. When y tends to infinity, x tends to 0. Because the denominator becomes smaller and smaller, y becomes larger and larger. And vice versa. Therefore, when y becomes infinity, x becomes 0. When y tends to infinity, x tends to 0. So, limit y tends to infinity, instead of writing this, we also write this as x tends to 0. Wherever you find y, you write 1 by x, 2 by x, 5 by x square, 1 by x. Now automatically with this, we can take LCM, simplify. Now you apply limit, you get 5 by minus 1, minus 5 by minus 1, you get minus 5. So in this problem, whenever you have limit y tends to infinity, you can make y is equal to 1 by x substitution. Then automatically x tends to 0 you can give. Multiply by x square, simplify. Automatically you get minus 5 is the answer. Now we can make use of these functions. Limit x tends to a of f of x is a. Limit x tends to a of g of x is v. Then limit x tends to a of fx plus gx is a plus b. Fx minus dx, a minus b. So, a minus b. So, if we have two functions, we can take the limit for each function, add product. If we have, we find a product of this limit. If I have x, so fx power gx, fx power gx, we get a power b. This is gx. It is like this. Gx. Fx by gx, a by b. So in this example, we are getting 0 by 0 form. If you get 0 by 0 form, that indicates
some factor has to be cancelled out. If you get 0 by 0 form, 0 by 0 form is called a indeterminate form. Some factor has to be cancelled. That's the implication. After cancelling that common factor, automatically you get the limit as 2. And 0 by 0 implies some factor has to be cancelled out. Similarly, infinity by infinity form is also called indeterminate form. Even for this infinity by infinity form, some factor has to be cancelled out. Another example, limit extends to 2 as x square minus 4 by x minus 2, 0 by 0 form. Cancel x minus 2 here, factorizing this limit is 4. In general, we are having a famous limit. Limit extends to 0 of x power n minus a power n by x minus a is n a power n minus 1. This is true for all n integers, positive integer, negative integer, rational, positive rational, negative rational, for all things. Once you have this particular form as extends to a, limit extends to a of x power n minus a power n by x minus a is n a power n minus 1. So in general, limit extends to a of x power n minus a power n by x minus a is n a power n minus 1. This is a famous limit. This can be used for all integers, positive integer, negative integer, rational, positive rational, negative rational, all these things. Okay, here the rational number is involved. X tends to 2 of x power 7 by 2, 2 power 7 by 2, x minus 2, n a power n minus 1. N minus 1 is 1 by 2 minus 1, 5 by 2. Even if you have reciprocal, limit extends to a of x minus a by x power n minus a power n. Here also it is reciprocal, 1 by n a power n minus 1. For example, limit extends to 2 of x minus 2 by x power 8 minus 2 power 8. It is of this form, therefore 1 over n a power n minus 1. So this is the required limit. 1 by 8 into 2 power 7. This is the required limit. Now see, this is a simple problem. A and B are unknown quantities. What is A? If limit is 0, 3 in this case. If the limit is 3, vice versa. Given limit, we are finding the constants here. If the limit is 3, what is A? Here automatically x can be taken out. Because automatically, otherwise it will get 0 by 0. X is taken out, you get A by 4, A plus Bx, 4 minus 8x after cancelling x. But A by 4 is nothing but 3, because this becomes 0, we are getting limit as A by 4. Limit is 3 given, therefore A by 4 is 3, therefore A is equal to 12. So we get A is equal to 12. So given limit, we can find A. Okay. Irrespective of B, whatever B may be, this is the limit. Limit extends to 1, 3 times x minus 1 plus 4 times x minus 1 whole square, 4 times x minus 1 whole square by 2 times x minus 1 plus 5 times x minus 1 whole square. Here also x minus 1 is a common factor. It is taken out. Limit extends to 1, 3 plus 4 times x minus 1 by 2 plus 5 times x minus 1 after cancelling that common factor. 3 by 2 remains as x tends to 1, this term becomes 0, this term becomes 0, therefore leaving only 3 by 2. So 3 by 2 is the required limit for this problem. 3 by 2 is the required limit. Okay. Now, before that, you must know these limits also. The second famous limit is trigonometric function. Limit theta tends to 0, sin theta by theta is equal to 1. Limit when theta is measured in radian. When theta is in radian, limit theta tends to 0 of sin theta by theta is equal to 1. Or we can also say limit theta tends to 0, theta by sin theta is also equal to 1. We can also say theta tends to 0 of cos theta, cos 0 is 1, therefore it is equal to 1. We can also say limit theta tends to 0 of tan theta by theta is equal to 1. Apart from that, limit theta tends to 0 sin k theta by k theta is equal to 1. By giving substitution k theta is equal to y, we can say y tends to 0 sin y by y, that becomes 1. Limit theta tends to 0 tan k theta by k theta is equal to 1. So these limits we can apply provided theta is measured in radians. Okay. One simple problem. For example, what is limit theta tends to 0? 1 minus cos 2 theta by theta square. Now in this limit, limit theta tends to 0. In fact, 1 minus cos 2 theta gives 2 sin square theta, or directly if you apply theta tends to 0, cos 0 is 1, 0 by 0 form. So something has to be done. What is to be done? We in trigonometry we know the formula for 1 minus cos 2 theta, it is 2 sin square theta. 2 sin square theta by theta square. So this is nothing but limit theta tends to 0. 2 times sin theta by theta whole square. Sin theta by theta whole square. We are having theta tends to 0 of sin theta by theta is 1. Therefore, 2 times 1 square is nothing but 2 itself. Therefore, the answer for this is 2. So, we are converting a form to a known form, sin theta by theta. Once you get this sin theta by theta form, automatically we get the required limit as 2. Okay. Suppose we have limit theta tends to 0 of tan 7 theta by sin 5 theta. It requires some adjustment. What type of adjustment? In fact, it is 0 by 0. Therefore, it requires some adjustment. Tan 7 theta by 7 theta into 7 theta. We multiply by 7 theta and divide by 7 theta. Since we are having sin 5 theta in the denominator, we multiply and divide by 5 theta. We multiply and divide by 5 theta. This is one function, this is another function. Here theta, theta gets cancelled, giving only 7 by 5 theta. This limit is 1 by a formula. This is 7 by 5, constant, unaffected by the limit. This is also 1. So the answer is 7 by 5. Therefore, 7 by 5 is the required limit for this problem. Okay. Now sometimes we have to give some substitution. So limit theta tends to 0 cos theta by theta minus pi by 2. In fact, by applying
limit theta pi by 2 here, cos 90 becomes 0, pi by 2 minus pi by 2 becomes 0. Therefore, we give some substitution, convert these as a known limit. What we do is, we write theta as pi by 2 plus h. We write theta as pi by 2 plus h. When theta becomes pi by 2, h becomes 0. And by this substitution, we can also give pi by 2 minus h. This way or that way. When theta is pi by 2, h becomes 0. Therefore, we simply say limit. Instead of saying theta tends to pi by 2, we can say h tends to 0. Instead of saying theta tends to pi by 2, you can say h tends to 0. But you must give the substitution here. That is, cos theta is replaced by pi by 2 plus h. By theta pi by 2 plus h. Pi by 2 plus h minus pi by 2. You know, cos 90 plus h, second quadrant, sin alone positive, cos is negative. Therefore, we get limit h tends to 0, this is nothing but minus sin h by h, which is equal to minus 1. Which is equal to minus 1. If it is pi by 2 minus h, you get plus 1. So therefore, cos pi by 2 plus h is minus sin h, because it is the second quadrant for 90. But co-function minus sin h by h, sin h by h gives 1, therefore you get minus. So therefore, for some limits, we give substitution, convert everything, get a known form, after that we can get the required answer. Okay, now coming to the differentiation. To consider a function y is equal to f of x. For this function, I am giving a small increment to x. X becomes x plus delta x. By giving increment to x, automatically y will take increment. Y becomes y plus delta y. When x becomes x plus delta x, y becomes y plus delta y. Therefore, y is equal to f of x. When x becomes x plus delta x, y becomes y plus delta y. Here, x is called the independent variable and y is called the dependent variable. We can give increment to x, independent variable. Automatically, increment is taken by y, that is delta y. I am subtracting. Your y is equal to f of x. Y plus delta y is equal to f of x plus delta x. You subtract. Delta y is equal to f of x plus delta x minus f of x. Then you find the ratio between the increments. Delta y by delta x. F of x plus delta x minus f of x by delta x. This is called the ratio between the increments, increment taken by y, increment given to x. F of x plus delta x minus f of x by delta x. You proceed to limit as delta x tends to 0. The increment given to x, we are making it smaller, 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 smaller every time. As delta x becomes 0, you see what happens to this limit. Limit delta x into 0 of f of x plus delta x minus f of x by delta x. We can easily see that gives us another function. Starting with one function, f of x,
you find limit delta x tends to 0 of f of x plus delta x minus f x by delta x, we get another function. We get another function. That function is called f dash x. That function is called f dash x. This dy by dx is nothing but limit delta x tends to 0 of delta y by delta x is denoted by dy by dx. And this is denoted by f dash x. You get some other function. You can easily visualize that function. The process of obtaining f dash x from fx, the process of obtaining f dash x from fx is called a differentiation. Is called a differentiation. The function f dash x obtained is called differential coefficient of f of x with respect to x. Therefore, I repeat again, whenever y is equal to f of x, x is the independent variable, y is the dependent variable. We are giving increment to x. The automatically increment is taken by y. Delta y is f of x plus delta x minus f of x divided by delta x. Proceed to limit as delta x tends to 0. That is limit delta x tends to 0 of x plus delta x minus f of x by delta x. Now, this is denoted by dy by dx. We can visualize, we can do it, you get another function f dash x. The process of obtaining this function by this procedure from f of x is called differentiation, and that function obtained is called differential coefficient. We are illustrating with an example. You can easily understand this with this example, the real meaning of dy by dx, how dy by dx emerges out. Okay, consider this table. Follow this carefully. It's a very, very interesting table. It is not given any textbook. Out of experience, I am giving this. You start with the function y is equal to x square. X is the independent variable, y is a dependent variable. At x is equal to 1, automatically y is equal to 1, substituting this function. X is equal to 2, y is equal to 4, x is equal to 3, y is equal to 9, x is equal to 4, y is 16. You can write all these things. I am making 1 as 1.1. That means I am giving increment 0.1. I am giving increment 0.1. Y becomes 1.1 whole square, 1.21. The ratio between the increment is 0.21 by 0.1, that is 2.1. The ratio between the increment at this stage is 2.1. Here 2 becomes 2.1, Y becomes 4.4, and ratio between the increment becomes 4.1. Here it becomes 6.1. I am making the increment given to x small, further small. From 0.1, I am making it smaller, 0.01. You find y, ratio between the increments, it becomes 2.01. The ratio between the increments becomes 2.1 by taking the increment as 2.01. Here by taking the increment as 0.01, the ratio between the increment becomes 4.01. Here it becomes 6.01. I am making it further small. From 1.01, I am making it 1.001. You find y ratio between the increments. We see that as the ratio between the increments, it approaches 2 here. When x becomes 1, it ratio between the increment approaches 2. At x is equal to 4, ratio between the increment approaches 4. At x is equal to 3, ratio between the increment approaches 6. At x is equal to 4, ratio between the increments approaches 8. So therefore, we can easily see that
as delta x becomes smaller and smaller, delta x is smaller and smaller, this ratio between the increments, automatically we see that it approaches 2 here when x is equal to 1, it approaches 4 when x is equal to 2, it approaches 6 when x is equal to 3, it approaches 8 when x is equal to 4, it approaches 10 when x is equal to 5, it approaches 2x when x is equal to x. So here that dy by dx at x is equal to x, it approaches 2x, that can be verified. So when y is equal to x square, dy by dx is 2x. That is, starting with this function, we are arriving at this function. This 2x is called dy by dx, derivative of this function with respect to x. So therefore, in this process, this process is called a differentiation. In this process, starting with any function, y is equal to x cubed, y is equal to e power x, y is equal to log x, greatest integer function, for all functions, we can find a dy by dx by this limiting process. By finding the ratio between the increments, as delta x tends to 0, we are able to arrive at another function. That new function is called differential coefficient of this function. For any function, we can get this function. So for x square, we are able to visualize 2x. At 2, 4, 3, 6, 4, 8, 5, 10, x to x. So therefore, for a function y is equal to x square, dy by dx is 2x. So what do you infer from this? For any function, in this process, we can find dy by dx. This process is called a differentiation, and the function obtained is called a differential coefficient. Okay, this is a very good example. You try to generate on your own many examples that you can really understand the meaning of dy by dx. How dy by dx comes out, that is very, very important. Okay, next class, we are starting, here I have given the explanation here, in next class, we are getting various dy by dx for various functions, we are getting dy by dx, and after that, we will start differentiation in a systematic way, so that anybody can understand, follow.